must get rid of this canker in our midst. That boy was born to be young, Mrs. Corney. Never been so shocked in all my days.
Oh, hush, Mr. Barmore. You must have quite a term. Sit down and have a nice cup of tea.
Thank you. Nice to be appreciated, Mrs. Corney. These here paupers in this here parish don't appreciate me. We have given away a matter of 20 loaves and a cheese and half this very blessed afternoon. Still, then, the blessed paupers is not contented.
Of course they're not. When would they be? Sweet, Mr. Bumble?
Yes, madam. Very sweet.
Continue.
You have a cat, I see, madam. And kittens too, I declare.
Yes, I'm so fond of them. You can't imagine, Mr. Bumble. And they're fond of their home, too.
Mrs. Corney, madam, I must say that any cat or kitten that could live with you, madam, and not be fond of its own, must be an idiot, madam, and don't deserve to live in it.
Oh, Mr. Bumble!
That's no use disguising facts, madam, an idiot! I'll drown it myself with pleasure.
Then you're a cruel man, Mr. Bumble, hard-hearted man and all.
Are you hard-hearted, Mrs. Corney?
Dear me, what a very curious question coming from a single man. What can you want to know for? Mr. Bumble, I shall scream!
I did, and if your hand is closed, I'll press it. Yes, you'll be.
I was needing a boy.
Good, then settle. £5, please.
If you don't mind, Mr. Bumble. Cash upon liking. Cash upon liking. This is Sarberry.
What
is it? Would you have a goodness come here, my dear?
What do you want? Well, what is it?
I've been telling Mr. Bumble.
Oh, hello, Mr. Bumble.
Hello, Mrs. Sarberry.
We were considering taking this boy into the shop to help out.
Oh, dear me. He's very small.
Yes, Mrs. Sarberry. He is rather small, but he'll grow, Mrs. Sarberry. He'll grow.
Oh, yes, I dare say he will. Our victuals and our drink. They're a waste of time, these workhouse boys. They always cost more to keep than they're worth. Still, you men always think you know best. What are you going to do with him?
Well, he has an expression of melancholy on his face, which I find very interesting. He'd make a delightful coffin follower.
Oh, what?
I don't mean a regular coffin follower for the adults, just for the children's practice. A follower in proportion. Superb effect, from what I think about it.
Yes. Yes, for once. Just for once. You might have had a decent idea. Very well then, boy. What's your name?
Mother, I'm Trussman.
A singular name.
I'm Alec. One of my own choosing.
Was Mr. Bumble?
Mine, Mrs. Sowery.
How's that, Mr. Bumble?
Boy's mother comes to us destitute. Brings the lad into the world, then promptly dies without leaving so much as a falling name and breath.
Dear, dear. Very well then, Olive Twist. Do you think you could look like that chestnut there?
Maybe I've had a black cat.
Never mind about black cat.
Chloe's quite right. Get the boy top hat. These things need to be done proper and correct. Stand in front of the pitch, boy. Henry? Henry, really? It takes you twice as long to do anything as anyone else. Stand out of the pitch, boy. Yes. Yes, for once, Henry. You've had a good idea. Very well then. Do you think you could keep that expression for a long time, boy? With a crowd?
know who I am, I suppose, workhouse.
No, sir, I can't say as I do.
I am Mr. Noah Claypole. And you're under me. So open up the blinds while you're up to the alleyway.
Hello, Noah. Saved a nice little bit of bacon from Martha's breakfast.
Oliver, shut the door and take the bits you see. Go and eat over there. And make haste, Mum, because I want you to mind the shop. Do you?
Yeah, workhouse.
Lorna, what a teaser you are. Let the boy alone.
Let him alone? I'm giving the boy change, you silly thing. Everyone lets him alone. His father left him alone. His mother left him alone. They all left him alone. Except dear old, kind old Noah. Hey, Charlotte?
Look.
Workhouse, how's your mother?
You need my mum rashes. She's dead.
Oh, what, she died, workhouse? Shortage of breath?
Never you mind.
Oh, but I do mind.
We better not say any more, see?
Better not. Better not. If you don't mind. My mother, he says. Oh, she was a nice one, she was. You know, workhouse, it can't be out now. And of course, it couldn't be out then. And I'm very sorry for it and all that. But you must know, workhouse, your mother was a regular, right down bad un.
What did you say?
A regular, right down bad un.
And it's a good thing she died when she did, because she'd been doing hard labour in a prison like as not.
Thank you.
little party for him. Dodger, take off the sausages.
Oh, they're stale!
Shut up and drink it, Jim. Ah, you're staring at the pocket handkerchiefs, eh, my dear? There are quite a few of them, ain't there? We just got out ready for the wash, Oliver. That's all.
Yeah. Is the laundry then, sir?
Well, not exactly, my boy. I suppose the laundry would be a very nice thing indeed, but our line of business pays a little bit better, don't you, boys?
No!
Working, eh, my dears?
Oh, rocks!
Good boys, good boys.
And what have you got, Dodger?
Cutlets.
They're not as heavy as they might be, but very nicely made. Ingenious workmen, ain't you, Oliver?
Very ingenious, sir.
And what have you got, Charlie?
A couple of those rags.
Well, they're very good ones. Yellow and green. You haven't embroidered them too well, though, Charlie. So you'll have to pick the initials out with a needle. You'll need to learn how to do this too, Oliver. Won't you, boys?
Yeah!
But in the meantime, we'll have to learn how to make wallets like Charlie and Dodgy. You'd like that, wouldn't you, my dear?
Yes, Mr.
Bailey.
You'll teach me.
Certainly, my boy. No, Fee. Just do everything that Charlie and Dodgy do. Make them your models, my dear. Especially Dodger. He's going to be a right regular little Bill Sykes. Now then, is my kerchief protruding from my pocket by chance?
Yes, I can just see the corner.
Well then, see if you can take it without my fee. Like you saw the others do.
Pleasure small.
Oh, ladies, I forgot to introduce you to our new lodger, Mr. Oliver Twist, Esquire, Nancy and Beth.
Charmed to meet you.
Oh, yes, we're all ladies and gentlemen here. We're all quality.
Yay!
You wouldn't know quality if you saw it. None of you.
Ted Lodge, you've seen the way their quality gents treat their ladies.
Of course I have.
Shall we show them how it's done?
Right, yeah.
Go on, Nancy, give us a free show on stage.
Yeah!
Nancy, go!
I'm there.
on his first job with Dodger today. And I'm afraid he may say something which will get us into trouble.
That's very likely. You'll blow the bomb, Fagin.
And I'm afraid, you see, that if the game was up with us, then it might be up with a good many more. And it would come out rather worse for you, Bill, than it would for me, my dear.
Somebody must find out what's been said. Or done. He hasn't talked yet. There's still a chance we might get him back. Without suspicion. We'll nab him in the very moment he dares step out of that house. Now, who's gonna go?
The very thing, Nancy, my dear. What do you say?
The very thing.
But it won't do, so it's no good for trying it on Fagin.
And what exactly do you mean by that remark?
What I say, Bill.
Why, the very person for it. Nobody out that way knows anything about you.
And as I don't want them to, neither. It's rather more no than yes with me, Bill.
She'll go, Fagin.
No, she won't, Fagin.
Yes, she will, Fagin! God damn!
Oh yes, he does.
He is not hungry, Mrs. Bedwin.
No, Doctor.
You feel sleepy, don't you?
No, sir.
No, you're not sleepy, not thirsty, are you? If that boy's thirsty, I'll eat my head. Are you?
It's not thirsty.
Just as I expected. It is very natural for him to be thirsty. You may give him a little tea.
May I get up now, sir?
I think you may. And take a little fresh air. Do not keep him too warm, Mrs. Bedwin, but be careful that he should not be too cold. Will you have the goodness? We'll be glad to be up there, Oliver. Doctor, do you notice the most extraordinary likeness between that boy's face and a portrait of my daughter Agnes? I can't say that I do. I know only two sorts of boys. Mealy-faced boys and beef-faced boys. And which is Oliver? Mealy. Where does he come from?
Didn't I tell you? He's a wretched for stealing my pocket handkerchief.
What, sir?
No, it was all my mistake. When the shopkeeper told me what really happened, I let him stay here to make the amends I could. I must admit, I find myself strangely attached to the boy.
He is deceiving you, my good friend. He has had a fever. What of that? Fevers are not peculiar to good people, are they? Bad people have fevers sometimes too, haven't they? He stole your pocket handkerchief, and he'll steal more, sir.
No, he didn't. Yes, what is it?
The books you ordered from the books, sir.
Thank you. Now, I've got some more books. Hey, come back.
I desperately wanted some books returned.
Send Oliver with them. He'll be sure to deliver them safely. If he does, I'll eat my head, sir.
Oh, very well. If you wish, you shall. Now, I'll tell you what I want you to do. I want you to go to the library and tell you come to play the 410 Mrs. Brownlow's. Here's £5. Now, there's no need to rush, but I don't want you to be more than 10 minutes.
Very good, sir.
10 minutes. Now let us see.
Thank you.
mother's heart.
She's not my sister. Got no sister. Got no mother. My father, neither.
Just listen to him.
Bert tells him he go.
He knows his little sister. He can't hide that.
Young wretch.
Oh, make him come home, or he'll kill his mother and father.
What the devil's this? Young Oliver, come home to your mother, you young dog. Come on home. What books are these?
Downlands.
You've been stealing again, haven't you? There's nothing but a thief and a vagabond. Come on.
Oh,
Neil. The gardener in Georgia. Now, the gardener himself.
Money you made, but goodbye.
show tomorrow that was done.
Huh?
Seems an age. I sold myself for 6 teaspoons, 2 sugar tongs, and a milk pot. A small quantity of second-hand furniture and £20. Oh, well, very reasonable. Sheep. Dirt sheep.
Sheep? You're in deer. Any price in deer enough. I paid you a lot of bum knows that. Are you going to sit there snoring all day?
I'm going to sit here as long as I think proper, madam. And although I was not snoring, I shall snore, gape, sneeze, laugh or cry as the humour strikes me, such being my prerogative.
Your prerogative?
I said the word, madam. The prerogative of a man is to command.
And what's the prerogative of a woman in the name of goodness?
To obey, madam. Your late unfortunate husband should have taught it to you. Then perhaps he might have been alive today, and I wish he was, poor fellow.
Oh, you hard on him, brute.
Cry away, madam. Opens the lungs, exercises the eyes, softens the temper, and washes the face, and cry away.
Information. Got
any
boil of a twist?
I come and answer to your advertisement, sir. Bungle's my name. Beadle of the Paris Workhouse. From where Oliver was cared for. From where he was apprenticed to an undertaker. From where he ran away.
Yes, yes. Do you know where the boy is now?
No, not more than nobody knows, sir.
What do you know of him?
This little trinket was given by the lad's dying mother to my dear wife, just before she passed away.
The lad's dying mother, that is, not my dear wife. You say that when he left your workhouse, he went to an undertaker's?
Yes, Mr. Sowery, the parish undertaker. Took all of a promise of £5.
You mean to say you sold him like an animal?
Well, it was actually Mrs. Bunker who authorised the sale.
Really? And that's a secret that neither of you is employed in the situation of trust again. You may leave my house.
Hope this unfortunate little circumstance will not affect my parochial office.
Indeed, it will, and you may think yourself lucky besides.
But it was your Mrs. Bumble. She would do that.
That is no excuse. You were present on the occasion that the boy was sold, and indeed are the more guilty of the two. The eye of the law supposes that your wife acts under your direction.
Well, if the law supposes that, then the law is an ass. That's the eye of the law, and the law is a bachelor, and the worst I can hope for the law is that his eyes should be opened by experience. By experience, sir.
There's a young person, sir, at the back door, inquiring for you. She says she's come about Oliver.
Mrs. Bailey, thank you for your furniture. You see who it is?
Why, is this Agnes, sir?
Yes, my daughter Agnes. And I have every reason to believe that Oliver was her child.
Sir? I won't stay out there much longer. If I'd have gone away as many would have done, you'd have been sorry. Not without reason, either.
I'm sorry if anyone's been rude to you. Can I help you?
I don't know. Can she be trusted?
Yes, why?
I am the girl that took Oliver back to old Fagan's on the morning he left your house.
You?
Me, sir. And I wish I'd never been a part of it. The boy mentioned you especially, and I thought if I came to you, I could...
But where is this place you speak of, Fagan's?
I can't tell you.
But what can I do about all this? How can you help me?
I didn't know nothing. All I knew was my orders. I had to get in here or suffer for it.
Did you perhaps
not? But you don't believe me. I don't want your pity. I had to come here, even though there are those who would murder me if they knew I'd been here.
Murder? But where is Oliver? Where is his Fagan's?
I can't tell you. I just wanted you to know that Oliver's safe and well. I must go back now, quickly.
Now wait, what can I do about all this? If you want, I can call the Bow Street Runners. If you tell them what you just told me, they'll see to it that you come to no harm.
Don't you understand? I must go back there. I want to go back there. Have a nice day. You see, back there's a man that I just can't leave. You see, I love him. Don't you know what it's like to love anyone like that? I understand.
I don't mean to interrupt, ladies, but I'm anxious about Oliver.
I won't tell you where he is, but I'll bring him to you. Not here, and that's too dangerous. Will you promise me that I won't be watched nor followed?
I promise you solemnly.
Then tonight, between 11 and the time the clock strikes 12, I will walk on London Bridge, and I will bring Oliver.
Thank you.
fighting up all I've got to.
Thank you. Codex Great. My love.